pelvic inflammatory disease. This condition you definitely want to understand, not only for yourself, but your family and your friends, because it can wreak havoc on the female reproductive system and cause permanent damage. This hits home for me because every woman deserves to not only have the right, but the ability to have a child. But pelvic inflammatory disease could get in the way of that. So today we're gonna discuss pelvic inflammatory disease, the complications of pelvic inflammatory disease, symptoms of pelvic inflammatory disease, how providers diagnose pelvic inflammatory disease, and how we treat pelvic inflammatory disease. So let's dive in. Before we dive in, if you like this video and you want to support this channel, please like and subscribe below. Again, this video is incredibly important, so try to stay throughout the video because I'm going to be sharing some invaluable information about pelvic inflammatory disease and also discuss some fun facts along the way. Also, pelvic inflammatory disease is quite often misdiagnosed, so if you have any of the symptoms that we discussed during this video, definitely bring it up to your primary care provider. Remember that pelvic inflammatory disease is also called PID, so I may use both terms throughout the video, so try not to get confused. So finally, we're diving in. What exactly is pelvic inflammatory disease? It's an infection that starts in the vagina and the cervix and makes its way up to the uterus, the fallopian tubes, and the ovaries. Just to go over some anatomy, the ovaries are these two egg-shaped structures where, you guessed it, the egg is created. When that egg is ready to move, it goes into the fallopian tubes, which are these two structures on the side, and they act as hallways where the egg is transported and goes into the uterus. And the uterus is the location where the egg implants, and that's where the baby grows and builds and gets bigger. Various bacteria can cause acute pelvic inflammatory disease, but the most common cause of PID is from untreated sexually transmitted diseases. As a result, the two most common bacteria that causes PID is Chlamydia trachomatis and Neisseria gonorrhea, gonorrhea and chlamydia, but also mycoplasma and other anaerobic organisms can also cause PID. Keep in mind that around 85% of PID cases are from bacteria that cause STDs, chlamydia and gonorrhea. I really want you to pay attention to that concept. If STDs are not properly treated, it can lead to pelvic inflammatory disease. This is a major reason why providers like us reiterate the importance of safe sex practices, getting properly screened, and also making sure you get treated if you indeed have a sexually transmitted disease in order to prevent PID from occurring in the first place. Next, we're going to talk about complications of pelvic inflammatory disease. The first one is fallopian tube damage leading to infertility. The infection that causes pelvic inflammatory disease scars up that fallopian tube, leading to scarring and blockage of that fallopian tube. Then the egg is not able to get through the fallopian tube and into the uterus. This causes infertility. And not one, not two, but 10% of women could become infertile due to pelvic inflammatory disease. This is huge. Next is ectopic pregnancy. What is an ectopic pregnancy? That's when the egg from the ovary is going through the fallopian tubes into the uterus, but the problem is the egg gets trapped in the fallopian tube. It gets fertilized by the sperm. It ends up growing there. That's not a viable pregnancy. The egg has to implant in the uterus in order to be a viable pregnancy. So what happens is it grows in that fallopian tube, causes extreme pain. This is an emergency and could be a life-threatening issue. Another complication is chronic pelvic pain. Now, whenever an infection causes a lot of damage, this could lead to lifelong chronic pain in the pelvis. Another complication is peritonitis, which is infection inside the abdomen, and also a pelvic abscess can develop. So what are the risk factors of developing pelvic inflammatory disease? Number one is women under 25 years old. Number two is women who are sexually active. If you're sexually active, you could get an STD. This could lead to pelvic inflammatory disease. Number three is multiple sexual partners. If you have multiple sexual partners, you have more opportunities of developing an STD. And the last risk factor is real obvious. If you get an STD, that could lead to pelvic inflammatory disease. So the last one is infection with an STD. Probably the most important thing you need to know about pelvic inflammatory disease is the symptoms. And the number one symptom that usually people present with is lower abdominal or pelvic pain. This can be very mild, but abrupt in nature. Other symptoms include pain with intercourse, pain with urination, abnormal uterine bleeding, abnormal vaginal discharge, and also some females can have nausea, vomiting, and fever. Remember that some women may only have one or two of these symptoms, and if you have any concerns, go see your primary care provider. When it comes to diagnosing pelvic inflammatory disease, it's very simple. It's what we call a clinical diagnosis, meaning all we have to do is assess the patient, evaluate the symptoms, do a physical exam, and then we have a diagnosis. No specific diagnostic studies like labs or ultrasound or CT is needed prior to treatment. Sometimes I get the question, don't you want to get an STD panel and get all that back before you treat pelvic inflammatory disease? I tell them no. The reason why is if we get an STD panel, which we do want to get, but we don't want to wait on those results. If we waited on those results, it could be multiple days before we get all those results back before we can treat. That's bad. As we talked about earlier, pelvic inflammatory disease can cause long-term complications in women, and so we don't want to delay that treatment in order to wait on some results. If we think it's pelvic inflammatory disease, we want to treat. Next is the treatment, and the treatment is simple. It is a 3-antibiotic regimen with close follow-up within 2 to 3 days. I'm not going to talk about the exact antibiotics that we use because those frequently change. And actually, fun fact, it recently changed for pelvic inflammatory disease. I will always reiterate that if you have symptoms of pelvic inflammatory disease, go see your primary care provider. That is key. Now, the good news is if you have symptoms of pelvic inflammatory disease and it's early, complications are rare as long as you get the appropriate treatment. If you have time today and you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe below. That will help a lot. Otherwise, that wraps up today's video on pelvic inflammatory disease. Until next time, take care.